And I'm going to just jump in. We've got about 25 minutes, saving about 5 minutes for questions and answer. And this is what we're going to cover during this brief webinar on the impact of COVID, this pandemic, and how it's affected nursing and how libraries can adapt. So I'm an associate professor in the School of Nursing at a large public university in California, the CSU, California State University, is the largest university system in the US with 23 campuses. I also have 20 years of nursing experience in a variety of roles in the service sector. So in other words, in hospital settings, and that's positioned me to be in a interesting position during this time. Our campus went into lockdown on March 11th, 2020. So like many of you, I'm sure you had an office in a building somewhere. Maybe you are going back to your office. Maybe you're in your office now, but I'm still working at home. This is my office. Is this the desk and my dining room table? I bought some tulips just for the photo. You know, on March 11th, our world turned upside down, and many people, nurses, of course, knew what PPE meant, but other people learned that acronym for the first time, and we're approaching a year now of being in this situation. We are still very much, though, in a deadly pandemic. So I think many of us want to keep our eye on the horizon. We're so sick of this. We want to be done with it, but we just passed a terrible tragedy yesterday in reaching the 500,000 dead in the US as a result of COVID-19. So I think all of us are struggling to try to restore some normalcy in our personal and professional lives. Some of us are being asked to return to normal before they're ready. That may be some of you on this webinar. Some, like me, want to return to normalcy before our institution's ready. They don't want us back yet, but we just can't wait. And I will say, I am doing research with looking at perianesthesia nurses' experiences during this pandemic that's funded by the American Society of Perianesthesia Nurses. And so there are very distinct regional variations in terms of how this pandemic has affected people's lives, not just nurses, just people's lives in general. And I would also say it's discipline specific. So on my campus in San Francisco, the nursing professors can't wait to get back to school. We want to do face-to-face classes. We want things to open up again. The library, on the other hand, is open. It's limited still, but it is somewhat open, and the librarians don't want to be back on campus. So it is also, I think, discipline specific, right? I mean, and of course, there's personal variations in terms of what your home life is like, if you're in a multi-generational house, you're worried about infecting others, if you are immunocompromised. So there are a lot of reasons why some people are ready to embrace normalcy more than others. So where are we going? The SARS-CoV-2 or COVID-19 is going to be with us forever. It's not going away. But we're all hoping that it will end up being controlled and managed as an annual outbreak like the flu, like influenza. I mean, that is our goal. And we would get an annual flu and COVID shot. That's the hope. Now, we may have a couple of vaccine boosters before we get to that annual event, because it is mutating so much and there are some very worrisome variants. And I have been very keen to read what futurists and great thinkers think about what the workplace of the future is going to be. And they're all over the map. I mean, I've read designers, architects, CEOs of Fortune 500 companies, opinions about what the workplace of the future is going to be. I think no one knows, but I will say this, a few things are certain. One is we will always need to educate nursing students, as the role of the nurse cannot be outsourced to automation. So, you know, we think that 25% of our jobs are all going to be lost to automation in the next, 10 years, but it's been sped up now, it's been accelerated as a result of this pandemic. But we will never lose nurses, because nurses, I mean, we may lose some nurses, they may try to automate some things, but the point is that people are hospitalized for nursing care. That is the end of the story. So we will always have nursing students, because there will always be nurses that retire and we need to replace them, and we need to expand the workforce, whatever. So also, nursing is a practice-based profession. So that's that has always been the tension for educators. And I don't know how many on the call are librarians versus nurse faculty, but that has always been an issue because education by and large happens not in the clinical setting, like it happens outside the clinical setting, yet it's a practice-based profession. So now that we're all teaching remotely, how do we bridge that practice education gap? So before I go into an example and sort of the insights that I and others have gleaned, I think, during this time, I want to just touch on a few definitions. I use the IOM definition for education and training. Education is learner-driven and allows learning to be tailored to the individual needs of that learner. And that differs from, say, training, which is when you standardize materials and processes to yield similar results. That's that whole sort of one size fits all. You've all had training, right? You've all had your mandatory sexual harassment e-learning module that you had to complete, or you've all had some sort of e-learning. Usually they're e-learning kind of modules that get pushed out by HR that everyone has to complete. So that's very different from, say, education. So I'm kind of focusing on education in this talk. But I want to say that regardless of, you know, the lofty ideals that we may go into with education, that if you haven't read the 2020 workplace study, I really encourage you to read it, because it was conducted, the researchers conducted interviews with kids in 2010, and they are now in our colleges, right? They're in your libraries, they're in our schools of nursing. And in 2010, these kids said, yeah, you can call it education, you can call it training, you can call it whatever you want. But all I know is I want it just enough, I want just in time, and I want it to be just for me. So that these are digital natives. These are people who live on tweets and really truncated social media. So this is a revolution that's happening in education, whether we're ready for it or not. And we need to be prepared to meet this challenge, because they don't want the old school lecture, right? They just don't want that. They want just enough, just in time, just for them. So educational best practices for a practice-based profession, I think it's pretty clear that multimodal education seems to be the most effective. But before I go to what that is, I want to sidestep for a sec and talk about what is multimodal. How do I think about multimodal? So I'm going to talk about multimodal approach to pain. We also know that the multimodal approach to pain is also the most effective. And so that's the simultaneous use of a combination of two or more analgesics that act at different sites within the central and peripheral nervous systems. And it requires the use of different agents that are synergistic to one another. So that usually means they're different pharmacological families, they have different mechanisms of action, and they have different peak effects. Why is that important? Well, we're trying to keep your pain, a patient's pain, managed at a certain just level, like let's say three on a scale of 0 to 10. We want to keep it at a 3, so a steady state. So to do that, we can't have the highs and lows. We need to have a steady state. And to do that, it requires multiple agents that have these different peak effects so that they wear off at different times, so you don't have a big trough, and also have different mechanisms of action. So how does that fit with education? Well, I think it fits really nicely, because the point is, we know multimodal education also seems to be the most effective, but that means that we have to have different ways of approaching the learner with different modalities that have different peak effects and come from different families, right? You can use the same sort of concepts with multimodal pain medication. And we want steady state. We don't want the peaks and troughs. We don't want them to just cram before an exam and get an okay grade in an exam, but they've actually learned nothing in the class, right? You want steady state learning. You want it to stick. So the first thing is we have to ditch the 3-hour lecture. Now, I'm a big fan with 3-hour lectures because I can do it. I can talk for 3 hours, no prob. And I learned that way. I mean, I've of a certain age where that I had the attention span, but that is not our learner today. And also, frankly, most educators aren't gifted in a 3-hour lecture format. So, and we know that students really can't learn for 3 hours, right? You can't absorb all that and actually learn for 3 hours. So flipping the classroom has been used by K through 12 for years, very effectively. And I think many of us have been dipping our toes into it in higher education, but it's been hard to do. It's a real paradigm shift from just the traditional lecture format. But I will say I had to do it during this pandemic. I had to radically shift my teaching. And so I tried it. I went ahead and embraced the unknown and I tried it. So I flipped my classroom. I utilized pre-work. So it was required, it was graded pre-work. And I used a multimodal approach. So I used readings, videos, I had some exercises, and that was in advance of the class meeting. So that prepares the learner for what you're going to talk about that day. The class meeting is when you're using your intellectual capital as the expert of the class, right? Like presumably you know this content better than the learners, using interactive class activities that are reinforcing what the learner learned using the pre-work activities. And then post-work reinforces class content using videos, clinical exemplars, case studies, quizzes, again, different ways of approaching that content in a multimodal method, right? Using different ways, different families of drugs, different mechanisms of action. Reflective work uses a different part of your brain. And there's a lot of research showing that reflective work helps to link clinical theory and skills content together. And so I like to think of the theory as being the pegs. Like if you think about a coat rack, the theory provides the pegs so that then the learner goes out into practice and sees something in their clinical rotations, and they can put the coats, that knowledge of sort of the practice, on the coat rack, on those pegs that theory has provided. But reflective work is what makes it stick. That provides the stickiness. And that's what we want for that steady state learning, right? We want it to stay. We want it to stay with them. Simulation obviously has been used for years. But I think because we all had to pivot on a dime during this pandemic, we started really embracing some very low-tech simulation, which was not ideal, but you know, the necessity is the mother of invention. So like a lot of us had to really embrace some very, very low-tech ways. I know there are a number of centers were able to do high-tech remotely. Our setting was not able to do that, so we used very low-tech that I'll share with you in a minute. And then during this pandemic, low stakes assessments have been encouraged because many students are having to have second or third jobs because people in their families were laid off, lost their jobs, and they're dealing with a tremendous amount of stress. So having 90% of the class grade based on test scores is not terribly empathic during this time. And obviously flexibility in all ways, allowing flexibility for deadlines, whatever. So, for many, this became the new classroom, right? So we know that hybrid and remote education have been used extensively in the educational sector, especially in for-profit education for years, and they've been doing it very successfully. But in the public settings, and I would say certainly in my university, we've been really like just dipping our toe in that. Like we really have not embraced it, but we had to embrace it during the pandemic because our school shut down, but we had to educate people. So logging into Zoom and actually running a class through Zoom was a new experience for many, a new skill set. And I will say now, having done it for several semesters, it works well for theory content, but still struggling about skill-based and practice content using that modality. So I want to take you through this sort of busy slide. This over here, this picture is a typical theory slide I would have in my med-surg class. So I taught med-surg nursing in the spring of 2020. I think I had the wrong date on that one slide about the pandemic, actually. This started in March 2020. So the wound bed, just I'm going to have a little some pictures of wounds. This is like my trigger alert, a little late now. You've already like looked at the picture down below. But so wounds heal by epithelial cells going from the bottom and the sides of the wound and fill in, right? That's how wounds heal. So that kind of content is well suited for a Zoom meeting, right? I mean, that I can easily do that kind of content and talk about it during a Zoom class. What we want them to see in clinical is this really gnarly picture down here in the corner. And sorry for those of you who are squeamish, but we're hoping that students would go to clinical then after having gone to a theory, going to a lecture, they've seen the lecture content, they go to clinical and hopefully they'll see a wound. Ideally, they'll see a wound being being cared for the same way that was discussed in theory. Often that's not the case, and they see it being cared for in a way that was not, evidence-based practice. Either way, it's a great discussion for the next class meeting, right? Because students bring forth their concerns, like, I saw this nurse pour hydrogen peroxide into the wound bed, and you said we should never do that. And I'm like, that's great. So let's talk about that. Why is hydrogen peroxide not the best wound, dressing material? So we want them to see that, but unfortunately, so many students were kicked out of clinicals during the beginning phases of this pandemic. And in some settings, they're still not able to go back to clinicals. So we have to make do, right? They can't actually go to clinical and see this in real life. So this is a piece of grapefruit. And I was teaching a skills lab at the same time I was teaching med-surg theory. So I told everyone to go out and buy citrus, hopefully a larger piece of citrus as opposed to like a lemon. And I gored it out. I told them to gore out their citrus, and I covered it with saran wrap. Many of them did. I covered it with red saran wrap for drama, for the dramatic effect. So then I demonstrated through Zoom while they were watching, I demonstrated how to pack a wound sterilely. I had sterile gloves. I had, my sterile packing. They thankfully did have their supplies. So they have their own supplies that they have that they normally would bring to skills lab. So instead of going to a mannequin in a skills lab and packing a mannequin, they were packing their citrus, and I would watch them through the Zoom, and I'd give them tips and pointers and help guide that experience. So that's very low tech, right? But it worked. I mean, students got it. And then this is the, we use the Moodle as our learning management system. So this is just one page, showing a screenshot showing for this skin section that I was teaching in my med-surg class. I asked them to skim the readings before class and then actually review any sections that are unclear after the lecture. For pre-work in this particular class, I had them watch a video. This was a MedCom video that was about 17 minutes long. That's a little longer than most of the videos were that I liked and found. Most were around 6 to 8 minutes, which was kind of like the sweet spot for attention span, but this one covered a lot of anatomy and physiology, and then also went into some of the sort of how to assess and how to manage the wounds. Then I always post the lectures, and then after every single one of my classes for that first semester of the pandemic, I had them do a reflective exercise, and I'll talk about that in a minute. And then I always uploaded a Zoom video recording of my lecture so that if they weren't able to attend in person, they could watch it later. So the point is, the class meeting, though, has to cover the content that was presented in pre-work. It all has to tie together for this to make sense, right? For this to be sort of steady state learning. So again, sorry, these are some gross pictures, but the students loved this assignment. This is a brand new exercise I had done with them this in the spring of 2020. And this is where I had a picture for, I just went to Google Images, truthfully, and found a bunch of gnarly wounds, right? Just pictures of gross wounds. And I had a picture for each student in the class. So I had several slides of this. And I would just call, I just asked people to volunteer. So people would, just say, I'll take the first one. And they would go, and they had to use words to describe what they saw. And that's really hard for them. They're nursing students and they are still learning medical terminology, but they're also learning words that don't even show up in nursing textbooks, like boggy. So this is a deep tissue injury on someone's sacrum. And this, I can tell you right now, having been a very experienced nurse with wound care, that if you were to touch this person's sacrum, it would be boggy. The tissue underneath is so damaged that it's spongy. But see, they don't know those words. They don't, that doesn't show up in a textbook. So I'd help guide them through the kinds of words we would use to describe it. And then they had to go on and talk about how they would assess it, how they would treat it, and then how they guess. They just, bonus here, they could guess about what it was, like location and what it was. Like this, for instance, this one over here is a fungal, this is a fungal infection. Totally bonus, because that's not really within their scope of practice, but it's kind of fun to do, make them sweat a little. They enjoyed it, they rose to the challenge, and they loved this. In my evaluations, they were like, that was our favorite exercise. This is the reflective journal assignment that I gave them. This was after every class, and I was trying to get them to really actually link what they saw and learned in theory, what they saw and learned in skills lab, like packing the grapefruit. And then if they had clinical that week, because our students were sort of on an every other week plan during this pandemic, the initial phases of this pandemic, what if they saw clinical that week, how did that tie in to what they were learning? Now, this semester, I'm still teaching remotely, although our students are having more time in clinical, thankfully. And I'm not using the reflective assignment right now. Right now, I'm using clinical exemplars that I drew from this book that I was a co-investigator and author on. So I happen to have the book in Word, that's handy. But not everyone has access to all of these resources. So I guess my plea here is there is help, leverage technology. There's a lot out there. And for the librarians on the call, you know that, you know there's a ton out there. So there's a lot of databases and there's a lot of skills-oriented videos, but I will say they're not all created equally, you know, and just going to Google and finding something isn't always accurate in terms of what's happening in current day practice. You know, videos are tricky because the content is not evergreen, right? Our practices change. Maybe that video was shot with people not wearing any PPE, not gloves. That's a common mistake. They don't shoot it with anyone wearing gloves. And yet most nurses wear gloves for almost all things. You know, when you enter a room after hand hygiene, you don gloves. So it's hard then as an educator to say, remember, wear gloves, when all the videos show everyone not wearing gloves, right? I mean, that's just annoying. So I do want to do a shout out here for the ProQuest Nursing and Allied Health database, because it's a multi-format database. It's a lot like multimodal education. I think it is a great database. It's got this mix of scholarly literature, it's got training videos, it's got reference materials and evidence-based resources. So it's a one-stop shop for faculty to go to if they're trying to pull together a multimodal educational content curriculum or content around a particular topic. So I just really do want you to leverage the resources you have, because it is really hard to shift from a traditional 3-hour lecture to a multimodal educational platform. That's very hard to do, and it's time intensive. And it doesn't always work. So I'm a big believer that erasers are on the ends of pencils for a reason. And so this is the same LMS screenshot you saw earlier, but I sort of skipped this one, glossary, because I knew I was going to talk about it in a sec. So this was an innovation I tried that first semester that we were on lockdown. And I thought, oh, this is going to be so cool. The students are going to love this. And I really thought it would be a place where they could crowdsource their definitions of words I'm using, like boggy, mushy, like things that, you know, like that are not showing up in the textbooks, and that they could actually like crowdsource that and like write what these definitions are from their perspective, what they think they mean. Because I don't always define these words. I just use them in context, and they hear them and they see the picture of the wound and they sort of have to tie it together. So I thought this would be so taken up by the students. Guess how many entries I got? Zippo, I got goose egg, no one used it. So, okay, so that one didn't work. You know, try again. So it is trial and error in terms of what is gonna work. What works with one class may not work with another class. So what is the future? Well, right now we're still in stormy. We're still there. We're not out of this yet. But I'm a hopeful creature. So I'd like to believe that change is on the horizon. And when I say change, I mean it both literally and figuratively. So, you know, I do a lot of work right now in the COVID-19 space. I'm doing a lot of research in that area. I'm a couple different research studies I'm involved with. And I'm following this literature very closely. Well, so as you know, for the librarians out there, most of that literature is open access, open source for everything, for all of us to look at, because the publishers and the journals, bless them, they're doing their part to try to make this available so that we can get a handle on this pandemic and get it under control. So knowledge exchange and information transfer is important. And that will not last forever. I'm aware of that, and I'm sure many of you are too. So getting access to, trials are beginning to end, trials that you had maybe at the start of this pandemic are now coming to an end. But the faculty still need those things because we're not out of the pandemic. We're still, many of us are still remotely teaching. So remotely teaching, we're teaching remotely. Many of us are remotely teaching. That's a little pun there. So the point is that this is a time to have close collaboration between the faculty and librarians, because enrollments have taken a hit, universities are cash strapped, and many of these resources cost money, like videos, right? Like having access to those things. Yet faculty, I think, now realize we really need these tools. We thought we could get by without them, but now we really need them. So if you are not best friends with your librarian and you're a nurse faculty member, become best friends. Likewise, if you're a librarian and you don't really know the nursing faculty, please reach out, get to know them. This is, that collaboration is so important in terms of making good decisions of the holdings and making sort of the best use of the limited money we have, so that we're actually meeting the needs of the nursing faculty, what the librarians can offer, and then also what the students really need to push forward. So I'm going to end with a few strategies for what I believe is going to be the new normal. First off, I've always believed that knowledge is power. So stay up to date and use your resources. And I know you know that, but it's also about teaching the students to tell the public that, right? So the students are in this unique place where they're interfacing with patients and families in their clinicals. And so this is when, if they're taught to say this, then they can pass it on. Don't get your medical wisdom from Facebook, right? That is not a credible source for all things medical. So this is about helping them to have the words to say when they're interfacing with the public. So staying up to date with credible and reliable sources and using those resources and helping the students to do that. Taking care of your mental and physical health, I think I certainly have seen this, and we know the research has shown we're all working harder. This past year, we've all logged more hours. And I think it's not because we're just like crazy worker bees and we just can't wait to work more. It's because our work days have blended into our work evenings, and our work week has blended into our weekend because, like for me, I'm sitting at my dining room table. So it's easy to just shove the laptop aside, have some dinner. Okay, pull the laptop back in front and center and continue working. That's not right. In the old days, we used to get in our car, we get on public transit, and we had some decompression time. And it was a sign to us to stop working, right? When you get home, you're done with the day and you can then go on with your life. So those breaks, those natural breaks, have not been happening for a lot of us. So I think before you can really fully care for others, you've got to take care of yourself. So really, please, this is a plea to take care of your mental and physical health, however that works for you. I mean, I put yoga, I actually don't do yoga. I'm scared of yoga, but whatever works for you. And then I will say that while we're physically distanced, a silver lining for me has been this open source, open access to all of this information, the databases and journals that I didn't used to have access to because of COVID. And I've started working with some researchers from other countries that I never would have had access to. They never had access to this literature, and now they have it. And we're actually reaching out and thinking about doing some research together. So that has been a silver lining to the pandemic. And if you haven't been really collaborating and connecting, please do so. That's also part of your mental health. Finally, this ASPAN funded research I told you about earlier, where I've been talking to these perianesthesia nurses across the country. One of my interview questions for them is, what have you learned about yourself during this pandemic? And they've all known that they were flexible, but we're nurses. Nurses are flexible. They didn't know how resilient they were. So I think all of us have begun to realize we're pretty resilient. If we're pushed, if we're against the wall, we're pretty resilient beings. So not all of you have been providing frontline care to COVID-19 positive patients in hospitals, and you may feel like you're not doing your part. You are all doing your part. You are all doing your part in the way that you can during this pandemic. So celebrate that. Celebrate that you are living through a pandemic and you are helping others to succeed during a pandemic. This is like a once in a lifetime, we hope, event, and it's a really hard year, and you guys have been helping others. So really celebrate that. And I want, because I'm a big fan of reflection, stop and reflect on what is your true north. So in hospitals, we talk a lot, if you use either the Lean or the Six Sigma, there are ways to think about quality, healthcare quality. In both cases, they talk about the true north. What is your true north? And so, of course, in patient care, we think about excellent patient outcomes, right? That is our true north. And every day we think about that. So from a professional perspective, for me, my true north always is what's best for patients, what's best for families, what's best for practicing nurses, and what's best for student nurses, because student nurses are the next practicing nurse, right? So during really dark days, during this pandemic, when I was, you know, Zoom call after Zoom call and meeting and just trying to pull together these multimodal classes was hard work, but I would focus on my true north. So I ask you to think about what is your true north. And during hard times, focus on your true north. It will really help you to push through professionally. And I would ask you to reframe. Right now, we've got roiling seas. This pandemic is not done with us, even though we would like to be done with it. But there are calmer seas on the horizon. So I actually have, I don't know if any of you are surfers, I actually have, I pay for a nominal fee, a subscription to Surfline, which is a webcams from all over the world pointed at oceans to help surfers, you know, decide if they want to go hang 10 in Waikiki Beach that day. I have it because I actually have those oceans up on my windows. I have different windows up when I'm working, and I look at, you know, live waves, right? Like live feeds from different beaches. And that literally helps me to reframe when I'm in a low space. And, you know, we have lots of rules right now. Bars are closed, or no indoor dining, or indoor dining at 25%. And I mean, just lots of rules right now. San Francisco is still the purple tier, and the rest of California, I think, is now in red. I mean, we just have so many rules, but that's not going to be forever. At some point in the future, of course, nurses will always encourage you to do good hand hygiene, but we'll just eventually move to just having probably an annual face covering recommendation, right? That during flu and COVID season, we'll wear masks. Right now, I don't know how many of you have noticed, but we don't have any cases of flu, like no cases of flu, because masks help, right? We're all wearing masks. So influenza really hasn't been circulating this year. And it's because we're masking and doing good hand hygiene. So that will probably become like an annual event, but the whole list of rules will probably disappear. And I am hopeful. I do see light ahead of us, and that always helps me to recharge. These are the references I cited. And then if there are any questions about content, obviously feel free to reach out to me. And if you have any questions about the ProQuest Nursing and Allied Health database, please reach out to either Danielle or Justin, and I think they're on this webinar too. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Daphne. That was really, really insightful and yeah, really great talk there. We did get a couple of questions, and so first one here is a question on how to do multimodal instruction in a 1-hour synchronous library instruction class. The nursing faculty expect me to cover what primary sources are and how to find them, what peer reviewed journals are and how to find them, database searching, finding full text. It's a lot to cover. I've tried to break it up with tutorials about peer review and primary sources to watch prior to class, but the students often don't do those things.
Yeah, okay. That's rough. That's a lot to cover in 1 hour. And I think maybe one thing is to have a crucial conversation with the nursing faculty to say that might be too much. You know, maybe I could split that into different talks if I could come several times. When a librarian comes to, I have a writing class that I teach, an evidence-based practice writing class, and the librarian has the whole class period. So that's a 3-hour chunk. So she does pre-work. And again, the pre-work works if it's incentivized. So I didn't really show you on my LMS screenshot, there's a little checkbox next to that because they get points for doing that pre-work. So that would be another thing to sort of bargain with the nursing faculty. If you're a librarian, say, hey, I want to assign this pre-work, but I want them to get points for it, because they'll do it then. They'll do the pre-work if they get points to do it. So some of this is also about working with the faculty to ensure that you can incentivize that pre-work.
That kind of, I think that touches on the follow-up question to that is how do you do assessment of library instruction in that type of class?
Mm-hmm. I think for me, it's really looking at the outcomes. Like I can tell you that the librarian who comes to speak at my evidence-based practice class, I can tell you that like they know how to search the literature. 2 weeks later, like we have them search it first before the librarian comes, then they have them search while the librarian's talking, and then a week later I have them search and they know how to search. So, I mean, are they masterful? No, probably not. They're the first year nursing students, but they at least now know their different databases and they know which database to go to with which kind of question. I mean, and that to me, that's looking at the outcomes, right? So the assessment of the effectiveness of that librarian talk is measured, I believe, by just the student sort of uptake, right?
Right. Okay, then we had a couple others here. Do you have examples of how nursing schools are embedding content related to COVID-19 into their curriculum?
You know, I think that's a great question. I think long-term, curriculum committees haven't really grappled with that yet. Ours has not yet. Well, I teach the med-surg nursing and I teach the advanced med-surg nursing. So, and I am sort of the COVID person in our department. So it's easy for me to keep on top of it and tuck it into my classes. And I know that the public health class, they've always done a big section on contact tracing. And so, you know, obviously they're just rolling that in. This has been the year of public health for them. So, but I don't think it's been officially sort of blessed about where this content lives. And I think that's a good question for ongoing for schools of nursing. They're going to have to grapple about sort of where does this live long term.
Okay. Some other big picture type questions. How do you think COVID-19 will affect the ongoing nursing shortage and what can educators do to help?
You know, I think this is such a great question because we anticipate there's going to be a rash of retirements when this is over. A lot of nurses I'm talking to in my research are hanging in there. They're because they don't want to let their teams down. So they're hanging in there until the pandemic's over. And then they're hitting the road, right? They're like, this has been so hard. I'm going to retire 3 years early because I'm done. Like, I'm so tired. So it's been really hard for the practicing nurses. This has been a really hard year for them. So I anticipate there is going to be a lot of movement in the workforce. But at the same time, hospitals have lost money during this year, especially in the beginning when they shut down all surgeries, right? Because I don't know if all of you know that surgeries are big money makers for hospitals. That's what basically keeps a hospital afloat. And so when they had to shut down surgeries, they lost a ton of money and they're buying all this PPE that they hadn't budgeted for, you know, all of that. Well, so the deal is, hospitals don't want to hire nurses, and yet there's going to be a mass exodus. So I think this is a really interesting question you asked. We're all watching this with bated breath because, out here in San Francisco, hospitals are not exactly ramping up their training programs, and I think they're going to be caught short-handed. I really do. I don't think they are being aggressive enough.
Okay. And then in terms of, you touched a little bit on mental health, is there what can faculty and librarians do to help the students, maintain their mental health?
That's another great question. I think, at the beginning of every day, I just ask students to turn on their camera. There's no requirement in our university to have your cameras on, but I ask them to turn them on just for like a wellness check. I ask them to turn them on just for a minute. I look at their faces and I ask, how are you doing? And if anyone's, and people, they have a relationship with me, right? I mean, I have like 40 right now. I adopted actually another section into my one section because our faculty member did get COVID and she was hospitalized. So one class I have 75, but that's large. Usually I have like 40, and I actually know my students. And so if one of them is struggling, they just say, I'm sad. I'm sad today. And they'll say that often in front of the class, which I think is so powerful. And I'm like, let's talk about it for a minute. So I've got a lot to talk about that day, but you know what? I'm going to make space for this because that's so important. So I think, and of course, I follow up with a lot of people in office hours, you know, private Zoom calls so that we can like make sure they get to the resources that they need. But I think being open and honest, I wrote the students when this first started, I wrote them a long email about how sad I was and how I sit on my balcony. I'm blessed to have a balcony, but I sit on my balcony and I cry almost every day for all of the lives we've lost. And I mean, so I've been really honest and transparent to students. And I think showing our own vulnerability is important role modeling to them.
Yeah, yeah, that really, that's really important. Then like one more question here. You know, the students, they have limited time in the skills lab, obviously due to COVID. And, you know, I think you talked a little bit about this, but, you know, specifically, what are some resources available to teach them better hands-on skills, you know, like IV insertion, medication administration, and sterile technique, those types of things?
Yeah, so this is just what we did. This is not, I haven't done a thorough review of the lid in terms of like what's out there, but I do know that we can't have students come into skills labs, like our university is closed. So we met through Zoom and we had them practice all of their skills. And then we got dispensation from our state and public health departments and our university to bring all of our students on campus for 1 week. So we bring that, so 400 kids come to campus and it is carefully orchestrated. They can't be there longer than 2 hours for an instructional period, and each room has to lie fallow for an hour in between instructional sessions. But we call it Mega Skills Lab, and we bring the students in. They've watched pre-videos, you know, they've done some pre-work, and they come in with their supplies and they're ready to start IVs, and they're ready to, and we just run them through the skills. So I usually demo it first and then they do it. So it's not ideal because it's basically taking a semester into 2 hours, but they're at least thrilled to have a moment. They're thrilled to have 2 hours with an instructor and actually touch mannequins and, you know, do those things, sort of showing their sterile field live so that I can like review it. Ah, you touched right there. You touched. Did you see that? You know, I mean, that they really are so thankful that they at least have that.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I'm not seeing any other questions here. So I, on behalf of all of us, thank you very much. I know I learned a lot, and I'm sure our audience did too.
Thank you. I'm sorry I couldn't see the audience. Next time, hopefully we can do that. Thank you.
Yep. Thank you. Bye.